We have been having good time this week, and many could not attend. You missed a lot, but you have been blessed today. Stay till evening, so you get all what the speaker is going to speak to us. Please do not go home. In case you go, come back as soon as you can. Come back to listen. Thank you so much, because you have been here. Let us pray for those who have lost their loved ones. The family of Ayivor, when the announcement was made, you have not come in. If you can stand, the Jamus, so you can stand. Tony Ayivor lost his father back at home. I know you know. You can say something you want to say about that.
Good morning, Judge.
Good morning.
Okay, remember you in our prayers. May the Lord be with each one of you and other families that have lost their loved ones. Next Sabbath, I will not be here. I will be attending a church at Oakwood College in Alabama, or a university, for medical missionary convention, and a few of us will attend there. So pray for us as we travel to Alabama next Sabbath. But Judge is here. Welcome many visitors who come to listen to the word of God. Now the speaker we have comes all the way from Africa, but he has stayed in this country for many years, maybe more than in Africa, maybe. And now he comes from North Carolina. He's an evangelist, a pastor. He has a lot God has given him. Now he's going to share just a small fraction of what he has given to him. A lot. Come. His name is Pastor Divine Ayiba. And the translator to vernacular is Jeremiah Montin. Welcome.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
How you feeling?
Good.
You feeling good?
Yes.
Everybody's feeling good?
Yes.
I'm feeling good too.
You want the translation?
I want to thank all of you who were able to come.
And
with you now for 8 days.
It's
been a good experience.
I
preach 3 sermons a day. I live in Nyambuka House. Rachel cook for me. Ontiri pick me up. Edith pick me up. Amen.
Amen.
Melan, pray for me.
Melan, Aaron Savera.
Marceline, pray for me.
Marceline, Aaron Savera.
And all of you support me.
Nah, what can matter of that?
I want to thank all of you. Those of you who watch on Facebook,
but more calling it on Facebook.
Some of you are here visiting.
Wanna, I want to know.
Anybody here from Alpha?
Then I will go and say Alpha.
Raise your hands.
Okay.
2 people. Welcome. Anybody here from Facebook?
Then I have from Facebook.
We thank God. This afternoon, I am going to do a 1 hour series on family life. You need to come back. All of you. Whether you're in love with your wife, or you are not in love with her, it doesn't matter. You have to come. Ladies, you got to make sure everybody come back. Because you're going to learn a lot today. That if you follow, you're not going to have a problem ever. Even if problem comes, you will know how to solve it. So you can be happy. So you can laugh again. You know how you used to laugh when you were 17? We want to bring that back. Today we're going to talk about stress. How many of you know what stress is? Only 3 people. But when I see all your faces, I see stress. You cannot be in America without stress. Stress is a state of mental or emotional strain or tension resulting from adverse or very demanding circumstances. When we are stressed, the following things happen. Your blood pressure rises. You are under pressure. You don't have time to eat well. So instead of eating food, you go to McDonald's. And you get more sick. Your breathing becomes more rapid. You breathe like you have exercise. But you're just lying down. You know you have a problem. Your digestive system slows down. You eat in the evening. And you go to sleep. But when you wake up in the morning, the food is still there. You are stressed. Your heart rate raises. You climb a little step. And your heart goes boom, 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 boom. And you are so young. Your immune system, it goes down. Your muscles become tense. You do not sleep well. If you sleep and somebody do that and you wake up, you can't sleep again until tomorrow. That is called stress. No rest of your body leads to stress. No rest of your mind leads to stress. No rest of your heart leads to stress. To avoid stress, you have to rest your body. To avoid stress, you have to rest your mind. To avoid stress, you have to rest in Jesus. Proverbs 3:5-6. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he shall direct your path. Too much thinking does not solve a problem. You should be praying to God for favor. Too much worrying solves no problem. Too much complaining solves no problem. Too many bills are your own problems. You have to slow down. Too little praying is not good for you. You need to spend more time praying to God for help. Matthew 6:33. Bible says, Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things, all the money you're looking for, all the big cars you're looking for, all the new house over there you're looking for, God will give it to you if you put God first in your life. Don't wake up thinking about money. Wake up thanking God for life. Increasing your stress levels lead to depression. And when you get depressed and you do not turn to Jesus for help, you will try to find other things to help you to cope. So you go to the doctor and they give you medication. Medication got side effects. They give you drugs. Drugs are really chemical poisons. Some of us start smoking. We start marijuana. Amen.
Amen.
Do you know goats don't eat marijuana leaves? And they're smart. But some of us smoking. Those are temporary reliefs. It quickly disappears, leaving a deeper void in your life. Liquor, a little liquor, beer, whiskey, wine. Do you know what those things are? Do you know what those things are? Everybody quiet. You don't know what beer is? You know what whiskey is? You know what vodka is? Yeah. Some people still got it in their bathroom cabinet. They put a little vodka there. And they drink it small. But they don't want nobody to know. God have mercy on us. It will not help you. The Bible says in Proverbs 21, it says wine is a mocker. Strong drink is raging. Whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. Proverbs 21:17. He that loveth pleasure shall be a poor man. He that loveth wine and oil shall not be rich. The problems we face in life are not new. Sometimes we behave like we're the only people who got problems. But problem will always be here. As long as we remain on this earth, we will have problems. Does God know that children of God will have problems? Yes, he does. When you read the Bible, Deuteronomy 40, 30 to 31. It says, when thou art in tribulation, and all these things are come upon thee, even in the latter days, that's our time, if you turn to the Lord your God and shall be obedient unto his voice. For the Lord your God is a merciful God. He will not forsake thee, neither destroy thee, nor forget the covenant that he made with your fathers. Look at how John said in the New Testament. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. Let us pray. Eternal God, King of kings and Lord of lords, we, your children, have come to worship you. We are opening your words. speak to our hearts so we can change. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. America has something called a roller coaster. You have one at Six Flags. It goes up. It goes up slowly. It comes down fast. That's how life is in America. Your credit score is like that. It goes up slowly. Then you have 600. Then you start feeling good. Then you have 700. Then all the credit cards start coming. And then you start feeling big. Then you can buy anything you want. You want a car, they say bring $1,000, they give you a car. You want a house, bring $4,000, they give you a house. You start feeling big. We buy. Then we buy too much. Then we can't pay. Then we take a second job. The stress begins. Then we can't pay the bill. Then the roller coaster start coming down. The credit score start coming down. All your problems just started. And it's so painful. You do well when you didn't have no credit. And you are doing fine. You can see your money when you work. But God bless you with credit. I don't know if it's a blessing. But whatever it is, it brings problem. Your stress begins. You cannot do what God says anymore. 6 days shall you labor and do all your work. But the 6 day is not enough. So you start looking at Friday night, thinking maybe you can take Friday night and work a little more. So you go to church on Sabbath. But the Sabbath started Friday night. How many of you know Sabbath starts Friday night? So everybody know. Okay. Then we're going to go from there. The world is full of problems. The world is very confusing to deal with sometimes. The world has problems that we have no control over. You wake up thinking everything is fine. You overcome one problem. Tomorrow a new one starts. A new perplexing problem shows up. Why do you think you have your budget in place? A phone call comes from outside. They need $500. You're the only person they have. Do you have to send it? Yes, you do. They don't care if you don't have it. You have to send that too. So your life is more confusing. What do you do? We are restless. We feel hopeless. We feel discouraged. Sometimes we confuse about our identities. Some of us live in constant fear of the unknown. Anticipation of something happening that we will not be able to deal with. When the weekend comes, we feel a little relief because the phone will start ringing. The creditors need to take a weekend too. Then the night falls and it's Monday again and the trouble starts. You have a phone that you pay the bill, but when the phone rings, you look at the number. And then you put the phone down. You cannot pick up your own phone. And that's a problem. How about Jesus? Because you know, it's the creditor. It's the credit card people. It's the furniture people. Some of us will rent the furniture for rent the rack or Aaron. Why don't you go to Salvation Army and buy something from there so you don't have to suffer forever? Amen.
Amen.
Some of us have been suffering for so long. We look good on Sabbath when we take off the Sabbath clothes. The struggle begins. We cannot help it. We are in it already. What do you do? We start thinking we have to find a way to make it work. Because we are heavy laden. There is a load on our shoulder. And we don't want nobody to know. We don't want to tell anybody. We also want to look good and be like one of the boys. But our spirit is dying. We need Jesus, amen. Matthew 11, 28-30. Read with me. Come unto me.
Come unto me,
all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your soul. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. God wants to give you rest. God wants to give you peace. God wants to give you joy and happiness again. Amen.
Amen.
But do you want what God wants to give you? Your own way has not been working. You're suffering more this year than last year. So you have to give God a try. Amen? Does God know what it is to rest? Yes, he does. In Genesis 2, 1-3, the Bible says, first the heaven and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it. Amen?
Amen.
Which is the seventh day? If you look on your calendar in your house, the first day is Sunday, second day Monday, third day Tuesday, fourth day Wednesday, fifth day Thursday, sixth day Friday, seventh day Saturday. I didn't make the calendar. It's the same calendar everywhere. Amen.
Amen.
God did not rest because he was tired. He did not rest because he had nothing else to do. He did not rest because he was lazy. He rested because he wanted you and I to learn that you cannot keep working all the time. You have to know when to stop. He knew that our time, life will be difficult. Problems will be everywhere. If it is not from your child, it's from your boss. If it is not from your boss, it's from a family member. Sometimes you have a problem in church because we label you as somebody with a light pocket. You don't have anything. So when you speak, we don't want to hear you too much. That's how life is. But God is telling you, if you can do it my way, a change will come for you. He will bless you. So he rested on the seventh day. He wants you also to take a 24-hour break on Sabbath and rest. So Sabbath keeping began in the Garden of Eden. It seemed to be the first law, apart from the restriction of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Before there was any Ten Commandments, Sabbath law was already here. It is very important to God. If you look at Exodus 16, God decided to try the Israelites before he took them to Mount Sinai. And he says, when they needed food from heaven, he's saying, if they obey my law, I will bring them the food. They don't have to work for it. They just have to go and pick it up. If they obey my law. What is the law? He said, I'm going to pour manna from heaven. Read it. And the Lord said unto Moses, I will rain bread from heaven for you. And the people shall go out and gather a second rate every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or no. Here we see that God has a law which was expecting his children to keep before he can bless their lives. It's important to him. You are preparing to test them to see if they will keep his law so he can bless them. He was going to give them a blessing. But unless they obey his law, the blessing will not come. Amen.
Amen.
So in Exodus 16 to 30, Moses went and told the Israelites that God is going to pour out manna. You go every day and pick enough for that one day. If you pick too much, when you bring it home, it will reduce to what you're supposed to pick. If you pick too little, if you bring it home, it will increase to what it's supposed to be. Are you hearing the message? Some of us want to pick a whole lot. And we're picking it. But when we come home, we can't see it. Some of us are obeying God. We cannot pick up a lot. But when we bring it home, the Lord make it stretch. The same Lord then, the same Lord now. So some people wait, and the Lord said on the Sabbath, don't go out to pick any. Don't go out after sunset on Friday. Except you are a health care worker. Except you are a nurse. Only the health care worker are allowed a privilege to go and work. Even that, do you know why? If I faint right now, you're going to call 911 and they'll come and pick me up. And they're going to take me to the hospital, right? If the ambulance don't come, you're going to be crying, right? And if they take me to the hospital, somebody needs to be there, right? Put your hands together for the nurses in the church. The rest of you, you are not nurses. So you have to come to church. Even the nurses, they have to try to see if they can make their schedule so they can come to church.
Amen.
You have to do it as an emergency situation. And God understands when you are doing an emergency situation or if you are just looking for manna.
Amen. Amen.
Don't be looking too much for manna. So the Lord has given you the Sabbath. Therefore, He gave you 6 days to do all your work, and you have to rest on the seventh day. So when they got to Sinai, He gave them the fourth commandment.
Amen.
That you supposed to recite every time. Do you know this text? Let those who know it, let's say it together. Remember
the Sabbath day
to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do what? But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord. Hold it right there. The seventh day is what? It's the Sabbath of who? If the Lord is not your God, you don't have to keep it. Amen?
Amen.
If the Lord is not your God, then you don't have to keep the Sabbath. But if the Lord is your God,
yes,
then you are obligated to keep the Sabbath day. For in it, thou shalt do no work. Your son, your daughter, your manservant, your car, or the stranger that is within your gates. For in 6 days, the Lord made the heaven and earth. Amen.
Amen.
The sea and all that in the midst. And rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed. Amen.
Amen.
What did you know about the Sabbath? And you refuse to keep it holy. That becomes presumptuous sin. You know what God wants, and you choose not to obey. It is presumptuous sin. Amen.
Amen.
God punishes that very badly. Numbers 15:30-38. I will do the first two. But the soul that doeth aught presumptuously, whether he be born in the land or a stranger, the same reproacheth the Lord, and that soul shall be cut off from his people, because he had despised the word of the Lord and had broken his commandments. That soul shall utterly be cut off. His iniquity shall be on his own head. Amen.
Amen.
I know you don't like this sermon, but I have to preach it. Amen.
Amen.
So the children of Israel were in the wilderness. And one Sabbath morning, they saw a man picking up sticks. We don't know what he was picking it up to go do. And they caught him. And they brought him to Moses. They said, this man is breaking the Sabbath. He's picking up sticks. So they put him in jail. And they went to God. Say, God, what can we do with this man? He has broken your law. And the Lord said unto Moses, the man shall be what? Read that word. All the congregation shall stone him with stones without the camp. And all the congregation brought him out of the camp and stoned him with stones, and he died as the Lord commanded Moses. Sabbath is a very important commandment. If you don't keep it carefully, you are wasting your time. The money you're looking for, you will not get it, and you will not even make it to heaven. It's very bad. And I'm telling you, because you need to know, I am in America 36 years. I didn't come yesterday. So what I'm telling you is truth. So listen to me carefully. Sabbath is the only commandment that God will kill you for. Exodus 34, verse 14. We are going to read this together. Let's go. Ye shall keep the Sabbath therefore, for it is holy unto you. Everyone that defile it shall surely be put to death. For whosoever doeth any work therein, that soul shall be cut off from among the people. Do you understand that? That's the first one. Look at the second one. Since days may work be done, but in the seventh is the Sabbath of rest, holy to the Lord. Whosoever doeth any work in that Sabbath day shall surely be put to death. I did not write the Bible. I can only read it. Look at another one. This is Exodus 35 too. It says what? 6 days shall work be done. But on the seventh day, there shall be to you an holy day, a Sabbath of rest to the Lord. Whosoever doeth any work therein shall be put to death. Take the Sabbath a little seriously, because it can destroy you. If you read, the Lord says no forgiveness for Sabbath breaking. And if you remember what we read about the manna, God knows how many years you're going to be on this earth. He knows how many years you're going to be happy. He knows how many of those you're going to be sad. He knows how much money you're going to be able to make in your lifetime, because it is He who gives it to you. You cannot make wealth by yourself. It is God who gives you the ability to make wealth. So you need to trust your life to Jesus. Amen. If you believe what I'm saying, put your hands together. So those who are sleeping can get up and praise Jesus for His loving kindness. Because it's good for you to know this. Because if you don't know, you're going to make a mistake. You're going to get the whole world and lose your own soul. Amen.
Amen.
How do we know? How do we know that Sabbath is Saturday? When Jesus died on the cross, we read in Luke 23, 27, 50-56, we heard, and behold, there was a man named Joseph, a counselor. He was a good man and a just. He went to Jesus to beg the body. What day Jesus died? Who remembers?
No, you don't think yes, I'm with it.
The Catholics call it Good Friday.
I
call it Bad Friday. So he died on Friday. And they took his body. And they put it in the tomb. And the Sabbath drew on. So the women who came with him to bury him, they ran home to make spices. But the sun went down. They couldn't bring the spices to embalm Jesus, because they have to rest for the Sabbath. Now, if they cannot embalm Jesus because of the Sabbath, what makes you think you can work for the Sabbath? You will not make it. When I came to
America,
I used to work in a factory. You know, when you come, you have to go to factory. I used to make $3 an hour. That's all. And then I have to cash my check. I didn't have a bank account. I didn't have all what it takes to open a bank account. So I have to go and cash the check. And they take some money out and give me the $117. That's all I made for a week. And it wasn't easy. But then in 6 months, God blessed me. I got a job working in Manhattan. I was working on Park Avenue. I was wearing a suit to work from factory. Do you know what I'm talking about? Every morning I wear a suit to go to work. And I was feeling so big. I can't wait for anybody to ask me, where are you working? Oh, I am working in Manhattan. I am like a white man. I worked the last day, 3 weeks. The month was ending. I was working for a young and company. It's an accounting firm. They say I have to stay for them to close the books. But it was Friday, sundown 4:30. I said, Chief, I cannot do it. They say, are you crazy? I said, no. They say, I'm going to have to fire you. I put my hand in my pocket. They have a card that we use for the door. I gave it to him. I said, I quit. I don't want to be fired. So I went and I took my bag. And I left. And I got on the train. I started crying like my mother died. I cried till I got home. I said, God, the $3 an hour, now I got $7 an hour. But because of you, I lost the job. Oh, God, I cried all night. I went to Sabbath, I went to church. I was looking at some of you now, looking very sad. Monday, I went back to the agency. They said, Divine, what happened? You were so good. Are you a Jew? I said, no, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. So you can't even work Friday night? I said, no, I can't. He said, sit down, let's hope we find something for you. So I sit down. And then something came up. He said, Divine, we're going to give you something else. Don't mess it up. I said, okay. They sent me to Wall Street. Now I'm a bigger boy.
Oh no.
Praise Jesus.
Amen.
Praise Jesus.
Amen.
You gotta wear pink striped suit.
Oh no, it's gonna bring it the suit here, yeah.
And when you walk like you have made it. I worked for 1 month. The same question came up.
Divine?
Divine? You're going to have to come to work tomorrow.
He
said, tomorrow is Sabbath.
He
said, what? I am Jewish. The vice president was a Jew. He said, what are you? You're from Ethiopia? I said, no. He said, you cannot come to work on Saturday? All right, 5 o'clock, come to my office before you leave. America, when they tell you that, at least you're going to get a check. You're going to be fired. So I started praying, oh God, again? What am I going to do? I went 5 o'clock. I was looking at him. He said, sit down. Sit down. Why can't you work on tomorrow? I said, I go to church on Sunday. He said, okay. Can you work on Sunday? He said, yes. Yes. So I'll give you a key. You come to work on Sunday. And when you come, take a taxi. And come to work. And when you leave, call for a taxi to pick you up. Because Saturday, there's nobody around there. Praise Jesus.
Amen.
Praise Jesus. Since that time, nobody had the audacity to tell me to work on Sabbath. God is good. Put your hands together for God. I want you to be encouraged that when you trust God, He is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, more than you can ever think. You will be afraid and you will not serve God. But God is big. God can always help you. He has what it takes to do what needs to be done. There are 3 days mentioned in the Bible. Preparation day is Friday. Sabbath is Saturday. First day is Sunday. So you say, preacher, how come everybody, a lot of people are going to church? on Sunday. But listen to the word. Sunday. Sunday is the day to worship the Son God. There are some people who worship the Son as God. And if you go to many Sunday churches, if you look on their screen, once a while they're going to show you the yellow sign of the Son. They're telling you they're worshiping the Son God. But we worship Jehovah,
Sabaoth,
God of the Sabbath, creator of heaven and earth. He is the one we worship. But preacher, how can so many people be wrong? How can people go to church on Sundays, a whole lot of people? I can ask you the same question. How could so many people be wrong smoking cigarettes? How could so many people be wrong being gay or lesbian? Because so many people are doing something that's not making right. What the Bible says is always right. God first. God is the Alpha. God is the Omega. God is the beginning. God is the end. What he says is only what we must do. For your life must be pleasing to God. Do everything you can for God to be happy with your life. For if God is happy with your life, doors will open unto you. Favor will surround you. Opportunities will come to you. Blessings will come on you. And you will have a happy life. In Jesus' name. Matthew 7, 13, 7, 13 to 14. Enter ye in at a straight gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. And many there be which go in thereof. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which lead unto life, and there be few that find it. Amen.
Amen.
God is good.
Yes, I
know. God is good.
Amen.
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 I left Wall Street.
You going to get the Wall Street?
To drive a yellow cab.
Garu Wall Street. You go get a taxi.
Because I want to make money fast, fast, fast.
Yeah, I want to get the Wall Street. I want to go.
I drove taxi one Sunday. I left home 4 o'clock in the morning. And I worked till 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And when I paid the taxi company, I had 300 in my pocket. So I started thinking, if I make 300 every day for 6 days, it's more than Wall Street can pay me. So I quit. And I got in the taxi. And I worked. I worked hard. I worked very hard. I slept in the taxi. Friday is the best day to work in New York City. Because 17 million people got paid. And they give you nice tips. But I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. So I work to 4 o'clock.
I put
my off duty on.
Is I coming?
And I go home. You know, Sabbath, your family have to sit down. That's the only time all of us are home. Because somebody go in the morning, somebody go in the afternoon, somebody go midnight, somebody go day night. So you don't see the family. But Friday night, for Sabbath, the whole family sit together. And we buy bread, and we buy grape juice. And we celebrate our own little Sabbath. Amen. My friends will call me. Divine, you're losing money. We made 300 last night. You go to church. You're gonna lose money. And I go out after the Sabbath finish. And I get in the taxi. And I drive to Sunday night. That's called double shift. And when I finish, I make more money than the people who work Sabbath and Friday night. Because it is God who gives you the money. You cannot. God cannot short you.
Yes, sir.
He knows your needs. He knows your problems. He knows your responsibilities. As long as you are not home, laying down in bed, waiting for a check, God is going to open doors unto you. God is going to bless you. No matter how it happens, you will not be ashamed. Put your hands together and praise the Lord. I know preaching Sabbath to Seventh-day Adventists is not easy. But we have an obligation. We have an obligation. Let's look at Sabbath in the New Testament. Let's go to the New Testament and look at it. In Hebrews 4, 4 to 10, it says, for he spake in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. In this place again, if they shall enter into my rest, seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter the ring, but they to whom it was first preached did not believe. Right? Again, he limited a second day. Today, after so long a time, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. I expect some changes after you hear this message. Verse 8 says, for if Jesus had given them rest, then will he not afterward have spoken of another day? There remained therefore a rest to the people of God.
I say, God,
for he that is entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works. So to keep the Sabbath, you need to cease from your own works. You need to let your boss know. Don't be afraid to tell your boss that you are a Sabbath keeper. And those of you who work for yourself, make it a point. Make it a rule. That before the sun goes down, you are home praising the Lord. And write down how much you make right now. And start keeping the Sabbath properly. And see how much you make. If you make more, take out what you used to make and send me the rest. Do it God's way. Do it God's way. And a blessing will come to you. We are obligated to keep all the commandments of God. For if we break one, or if we neglect to keep one, it becomes sin for us. Look at what James said. James 2:10. For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he's guilty of all. James 4:17. Therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him he shall be seen. So preacher, what is wrong if I work on Sabbath to make some money? There is everything wrong with it, because you're depriving God of your presence. You are not the man you're supposed to be, and the blessing that God wants to give you, you are not going to get it. Number two, you make the money, but you're wasting your time. God will disturb every penny you make. Amen. Haggai chapter 1, verse 6. You can write it down. So when you go home, you look at it. Haggai. H-A-G-G-A-I. It says, ye have sown much and bring in little. You eat. You don't have enough. You drink. You are not filled with drink. You clothe you, but there is none warm. And neither earneth wages. Earneth wages to put into bed with holes. God will make a hole in your pocket. The money will not stay. What if I do not return a faithful tithe? You know your tithe, you make $100, you make $1,000, your tithe is $100. What if I bring only $20? Will God be happy with what I bring? God know more math than you do. Haggai chapter 1, verse 9. It said you look for much, no, it came to little. And when you brought the little home, I blow upon it. Said the Lord of hosts, because of my house that is waste, you run every man to his own house. God will punish you with car breakdowns. Your children will have problems, and your life will never be on track. So you need to be faithful in returning to God what is His. Somebody asked me, Pastor, instead of bringing tithe to church, my grandmother needs help. Can I take the tithe and give to my grandmother? Because I'm doing a poor person a favor. The tithe is not yours to give. You can't be giving other people's things away because you want to be nice. The tithe belongs to God. Your rent money belongs to the landlord. Your light bill money belongs to the light company. Your insurance money belongs to the insurance company. You have to pay everybody, including God. And what is left is yours. If you want to give it away, feel free to do that. But don't give away God's money. Don't give away your rent money. If not, you'll be homeless. And we can't help you. And then God got something else he will do. In Malachi 3, 8 to 9, so will a man rob God? Yes, he have robbed me. But he said, why have we robbed thee? In tithes and offering. You are cursed with a curse. For you have robbed me. Even this whole nation. Amen.
Amen.
So don't want God to curse you. Return your faithful tithe and offering. Don't let God shorten your happiness. Keep the Sabbath holy. Be bold to tell the people you work for that I am a seventh-day Adventist. And they themselves, when they see the sun going down, they will tell you to go home. Amen.
Amen.
Do we get blessings for keeping the law? Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city. Isaiah 58, if thou turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your own pleasure, on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable. Not do your own ways. Or find your own pleasure. That pleasure, you need to talk to me this afternoon so I can explain it to you. Not speaking your own words. Then shall thou delight yourself in the Lord. And I will cause thee to ride upon the high places of the earth, and feed thee with the heritage of
Jacob,
your father.
So, you know,
God will bless you.
Yes,
God can make you comfortable.
Yes,
some say Sabbath is Jewish. If it is Jewish, then the entire Old Testament is Jewish. The entire New Testament is Jewish. In fact, Jesus himself is Jewish. I know you love the Lord, and you're
going
to do what the Lord says. Amen. John 14:15
says,
so if you love me, keep my commandments. No more worries. No more stress. God says in Psalms 84:11, for the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. I want to pray for somebody today. I want to pray for somebody who said,
Pastor,
pray for me, for God to give me strength to keep his commandment, to keep the Sabbath holy, and do what he wants me to. Raise your hand if you want that prayer. Stand to your feet if you want. I have baptism this evening. And after, immediately we leave here, somebody is making a decision You are in the valley of decision. You are thinking of it. You are waiting for a better day. You want to join the church of God. You used to be very good before. But the pressures of life have caused you not to be faithful to your God. And you're saying, preacher, pray for me. That one day I will give my life to Jesus. Is there one? I'll preach for 10 days. There got to be somebody who is saying, Lord, I stretch my hands to thee. Help me. Give me the grace and power to do your will. Is there one? Church? Candidates who will be baptized today, can you join us in front? Those who want to.
Come.
There is no shame in it. Put your hands together for those who are coming. That's how we all came. We all came forward to be baptized, to join God's people. If you know you just need to make your calling and election sure, just come forward. There's no shame in it. It's you clearing the path with Jesus. Say, Jesus, take me. All to Jesus.
One more person.
Who is going to
come?
One
You want to commit yourself. It's the time. You never know. Such a time will come again soon.
I surrender all.
Call for baptism and re-baptism. Come forward.
The people are baptized last year who are still here. The people are baptized last year who are here.
But if you have a decent way, can I
let me go? My hand.
If you don't want to, but what is to get here in America? But what is it?
Baptized last year. Just come and shake my hand. It's a blessing. You on this side. It's a blessing. It's a blessing. It's a blessing. It's a blessing. Holy God. Shall we pray at this moment? Let's go ahead. We pray. Yes, God, our vow is to belong to you completely. And at this moment, God, you have seen your children. How they have been struggling to make a decision completely to come forward. And now they have been victorious. They have come forward. They need to have a closer walk with you. So those who have come forward, God, we thank you on their behalf. We commit them to you now, God. Those who are going to be baptized at this moment, and those who will follow, God, we continue to thank your name for what you are doing for your people. Take them, God. Save them completely. There are those who were baptized last time. They are here with us. We thank you that you have been walking with them. And we pray that you continue walking with them the rest of their lives. And those who have not decided yet, God, so I pray that the Spirit may speak to that individual before this day is over. That individual also can enjoy the baptism for this day and forever continue walking in your footsteps. Thanks for accepting us. Now we are on this break and we come back
we continue learning from you. For this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you guys. Go back to your seats. Appreciate you. Appreciate you. Appreciate you. Appreciate you.